I take a lecture theater. I was giving lecture in America, UK, and Thailand, Japan, and Korea, but this is one of the best lecture theater I've ever been. So I'm very proud of being here. And today, my topic is the origin and development of Buddhism. But when I first informed Mahachula, IBSC asked me to talk about development of the Buddhism. So how the Buddhism developed from India to northwestern India and to Sri Lanka, and from Sri Lanka to Southeast Asia, and the northwestern India to China. That's the main part they'd like asked me to give a lecture. So today I mainly prepare the development of the Buddhism, not the origin. So if anyone who is interested in origin of Buddhism, I nowadays use YouTube channel. This is my YouTube channel called Minute Buddhism, where you can have my English lecture as well as a Korean lecture. So in YouTube, you just write down mini Buddhism, then you can come in here. And here is some of the conference presentation I was given in UK or America or India. But also, I have a series of lecture on the life story of the Buddha, and it will continue. It will continue. I'm going to cover up all the way to the Mahayana Buddhism in China. So maybe you can check. You can check my YouTube. So I don't want to talk too much about the origin of the Buddhism. Today I'm mainly, how can I remove it? This one. Today I'm mainly talking about development of the Buddhism. So you may remember the Buddhism start in the northeastern part of the India, and from there Buddhism stay until the time of the King Ashoka of Mauryan Empire. That's around the 250 before Common Era. We are not sure exactly when it was, but around that time Buddhism was kind of a local religion, not a kind of a universal religion expanding all throughout the East Asia and Southeast Asia. Buddhism was there. And then during the time of the King Ashoka, Buddhism starting to expand through the driving force of the Mauryan Empire, Buddhism moving to the central part of the India and to the southern part of India. And also Buddhism moving to the central and the northwestern part of India. So this is one of the most important occasion occur during the time of the King Ashoka. And that event, we usually call it as a Sangiti. Sangiti means chanting together. So during the time of the King Ashoka, we have the third council, the third chanting together of all the important venerables to make formalize some kind of a viewpoint, some kind of a theory or doctrine, they'd like to use it. So during that time, there was a big schism, separation occur within the traditional Sangha, which make Buddhism develop. One Buddhism develop into the south, the other Buddhism develop into the northwest. So that's the one of the most important occasion. So today, I'm going to start with the Sangiti, or Buddhist Council. So Buddhist Council, you remember, we have three major Buddhist Council after the Buddha passing away. So the first one was called the Rajagriha Council, where we Buddhists gather together in the Rajagriha after the Parinirvana of the Lord Buddha, and they, according to the southern Buddhist tradition, they establish or formalize or compose Sutta, Abhinaya, and Abhidhamma. We are not exactly sure according to the academic viewpoint of view, but I assume there must be some kind of a meeting. Maybe number 500, number 700, a bit too much. But the leader of the important religion has just passed away, and the disciples didn't do anything. That's a bit absurd. So I think there must be some kind of a meeting. So I was there in Rajagriha when I have a. Oh, this is. 왜 잘 안 되냐? I was there when I have a. Sorry, I was there in Rajagriha when I had field work, and I traveled around the Saptaparini Cave. Saptaparini Cave is the place where we suppose they are supposed to have the first Buddhist council, and I try to have a drone movie when I was there, mainly because according to the Buddhist tradition, 500, sometimes 700, you know, arahat or Buddhist saint together, they do the sanghiti. But the area when I was saw in this Saptaparini cave, very small, it's not the place for 500. So I was just checking the area surrounding, and I found out that around the 1920, when John Marshall was the head of you know, archaeological survey of India, he actually checked this place. And the Saptaparini means, Sapta means seven, and the Parini is a leaf. So it's the name of the tree, and the name of the tree become name of the cave. So he was not sure, and I'm also not sure. So when I was checking Rajagriha, as well as this Saptaparini cave area, I found out that cave itself may be dedicated to the maybe Mahakashyapa or Ananda or Upali or very important Theras. But 700 or 500 monk can gather together, because this area was a huge area when I was there, when I was checking. And the Rajagriha, as you can see here, surrounding area was very fertile rice field. And the inside of this city was ancient Rajagriha, which was the capital of Magadha kingdom. So they can support, you know, they have enough economic power to support a large number of Buddhist monks gathered together. And this one. So here in Saptaparini cave, the cave was down there here, and we have a giant temple. But behind here, there is one ancient ruin. And according to the John Marshall, that must be the place where Buddhist monk, huge number of Buddhist monk gathered together to do have their first council. So anyone would like to visit Saptaparini, I recommend to visit there. Because if you go up there, this is a totally flat area. So the Buddha usually said, monk should stay neither too close to the village nor too far away from the village. So this is a perfect place. So I assume there must be a big gathering. I'm not sure about 500, but there must be a big gathering. In that big gathering, they established the major Buddhist text, the Sutta, Vinaya, and Abhidhamma. The Sutta start with the Venerable Ananda, Ebamme Suttam. Thus, I heard thus. And Vinaya starting with the Upali, Ekkam Samayam. At one time, there was a fighting between monk. Buddha intervened and settled down, and he made the rule. So that's the Vinaya. And Abhidhamma, how Abhidhamma can be the word of the Buddha? Anybody has got any idea? The Buddha... When he was thinking about his mother already passed away 1 week after he was born. But the Buddha checking where his mother was reborn, and he found out that the mother was reborn in the Tushita heaven, you know, 5-year-old boy. So Buddha going up to the Tushita heaven during the Wassa retreat, and he made a summary of all his teaching delivered to his mother together with the heavenly figures like God Indra, God Brahma, and so on. So Sariputta, every day going up to the Tushita heaven, hearing the talk of the Buddha, and every night he going down and deliver the message of the Buddha to Sariputta's disciple. So we are not sure, but that must be occur according to the Theravada tradition in this area. In this area, so they successfully gather together, Tipitaka, triple Buddhist literature, kind of Buddhist literature. They successfully forming together. So that's the starting point of a Buddhist Sangha after the Buddha passed away. So it might be very nice Buddhist Sangha continue to be state age one, but that's not the universal law. In Buddhism, we usually say the anicca, anicca. Anicca means nothing lasts forever. So Buddhist Sangha, maybe it will continue age one, as a unity. It might be ideal, but the world we are living in, that's impossible. So nothing lasts forever. So Buddhism is going to change, undergoes a kind of changes. So Etienne Lamotte, one of the most well-known Buddhist scholar in Belgium, once said, "The absence of a hierarchy and the leadership make it difficult to protect the Buddhism from disjunctive tendencies and actions." So Buddhism, according to the Buddha, anyone who remove all their passion and attachment, they are all equal. So the Buddha was an arahat. Anyone who succeeded in removing everything, he was the arahat. So they are arahat. They are all equal. So there was no hierarchy within the Buddhist Sangha. And that Buddhism starting to settle down in various areas. And then, fighting occur. And the first fighting, we usually call second Buddhist council, which was called the Baishali council. In this case, this is all about the fighting between urban and young generation of monk against the rural and traditional monk, I assume. And it was called, according to the Buddhist text, the fighting begin when elderly monk called the Yasa visit Baishali. And Baishali during that time, maybe around 300 people common era, flourishing merchant town. So in India, we usually said the first urbanization occurred not in the Ganges River, but in the Indus River. So we call it as a Indus Valley civilization. There we have a first urbanization occurred. So Harappa or Mohenjo-daro, that's the first Indian city-state, developed there. And then because of the climate change, around 1,700 people common era, that area become deserted. People moving there from the west. And then during that time, people who speak Sanskrit language coming into India from the north, they mixed up in Punjab, northwestern part of the India, and then they keep moving to the west. And then the second urbanization occur in the lower or middle part of Ganges River Valley area, around 600 to 400 people common era. And that's the time Buddhism established, and that's the time Jainism established there. That's the time Hindus establish their idea of samsara, rebirth, and their idea of karma. So that's the very critical stage. And the urbanization is one of the key for the success of the Buddhism, because Buddhism cannot be the religion of a Kshatriya or warrior class, because you know, Buddhist the soldier, when they were in the war, they have to kill for the fame of the king. So when they win the war, all the fame goes to the king, and all the Buddhist soldier fighting for the king will be ended up with the hell, you know. So I have to say, Buddhism cannot be the religion of a warrior class. Buddhism always against the Brahmins. So Buddhism, I have to say, is a religion of a city merchant class, newly getting the power during the urbanization. So the first disciple of the Buddha, Dakpusha and Balika, they are merchant. According to the Burmese Buddhist tradition, they were from Yangon. According to the Northwestern Buddhist tradition, they were from Hadha in north of the Pakistan. We are not sure, but they are merchant. And the supporter of early Buddhism during the time of the Buddha, you remember, mostly from the merchant class in Varanasi, merchant class in Rajagriha, merchant class in Shravasti. So the name Gahapati, repeatedly occur in the Buddhist text, because they are the main driving force for the early Buddhism established. So, you know, city is the place where Buddhism developed. City is the where Buddhism getting grow. But, you know, usually elderly monk, more traditional monk, usually stay in the, how can I say, rural area. That the kind of a tendency. In Korea nowadays, young generation of people living in the city, Seoul, and so on, and elderly people usually living in the countryside. So I think that similar thing occur during the time when this second Buddhist council occur. So a city monk, they had to adapt the economic growth of the city. You know, the city developed very fast. So they can't live with all the vinaya, all the precept. So they changed some of the rules there. And Yasa was an elderly monk from the rural area in the west, visit Vaishali. He became very upset because what the city monk did was against the Buddhist law. And Yasa actually summarized 10 you know, unlawful behavior young monk in Vaishali usually do. But if you see here, not really serious, except for number 10. The first one, salt in a horn. According to Buddhism, monks shouldn't keep the salt, because if you put the salt on the food, it becomes very delicious. So you will be attached to the delicious food. So it's prohibited. And also salt is like money, you know, in Rome, the salary was given by salt. So salt is the money, almost like money, so prohibited. It's okay in the rural area, but in the city, without salt, you know, the vegetables gone up very fast. But when they put some salt, they can keep the food. So they can eat maybe tomorrow, maybe the day after. It's a very important ingredient. So they do it. And the traditional Buddhist point of view, that's impossible. And the second one, two fingers. Do anybody know two fingers? You know, no food after 12 o'clock. That's a very strict rule. So whenever I visit Thailand, my monk friend asked me, where do you from? And I said, I'm from South Korea. And they said, you Mahayana. And what? And they said, eating dinner. That's against the Vinaya. They usually said, that's okay. But during the time when, you know, in the city of Vaishali, monks in the city very busy. So some monk eat after 12 o'clock, you know. They use a solar watch, you know, that sort of thing occur. And also something I like here, partaking of sour milk and drinking new palm wine. The water is very important. And the water, if you just put it there under the sun, it will be gone up very easily. But if you put some alcohol inside there, it can be drinkable for almost 1 week. So some monk are starting to put some, fermented, fermented juice, it's alcohol inside there, and it tastes good, and they can drink longer. So that sort of thing, that sort of thing. But the most important thing is the number 10, taking gold and silver, taking gold and silver. Traditionally, until around 1990, we believe this is the main reason why Buddhism separate. We call it as a major separation of a Buddhist order, Gumbon Bunyul in Korean or Chinese. It's a major separation of Buddhist Sangha to the Stavira and Mahasanghika. But this is impossible because nowadays we have six kind of Vinaya still survived. We can check it. The first one called Dharmaguptaka Vinaya. Dharmaguptaka Vinaya translated in Chinese and survived there. So Korean Buddhist, Chinese Buddhist, Japanese Buddhist follow Dharmaguptaka Vinaya rules. So that Vinaya survived. And also we have Mahishashaka Vinaya, another Chinese translation of early Buddhist Vinaya survived there. Mahishashaka is one of the subsect of Sarvastivada, one of the early Buddhist Sangha. And also we have Sarvastivada Vinaya, one of the most strongest Buddhist Sangha in northwestern India, that also survived. And we have, of course, Pali Vinaya. And we have Mulla Sarvastivada Vinaya. Mulla Sarvastivada Vinaya, I will talk about it to you later, but it established later, around the 600, 700, when Buddhism, Buddhist monk gather together, different sort of Buddhist, they all gather together into the Buddhist herb like Nalanda or Vikramashila or Sarnath. And then they check different kind of Vinaya, and they all mix together and make a very big Vinaya. That was called Mulla Sarvastivada Vinaya. And the Tibetan Buddhist follow Mulla Sarvastivada Vinaya. And then we have one more. That was called Mahasanghika Vinaya. Mahasanghika Vinaya. So if this is the reason why Buddhism separated, Mahasanghika Vinaya strictly prohibit taking gold and silver. And when I checked Mahasanghika Vinaya, it actually said, in any occasion, Buddhist monk shouldn't accept gold and silver. It's strictly prohibited. So it's a very nice story. Could be the big fighting, but not the serious problem during that time. And I think the monk, young monk in Vaishali, they were kicked out from the Buddhist Sangha at the end of the Second Buddhist Council. And the real reason why Buddhist Sangha separate, I think, is this one. It is called Pataliputra dispute. Pataliputra dispute. There was a monk called Mahadeva appear in Pataliputra, and he said, Arahant or Buddhist saint or elderly monk in the Buddhist temple, they insisted they are Arahant, but they cannot be the Arahant according to their behavior and their knowledge. So Mahadeva actually said, there are five problems among the Buddhist saint or elderly monk in the Buddhist Sangha. And here is the five point, but I can summarize just three. The first one, Arahant can be led astray by others. So anyone who said, I'm the Arahant, so when they visit Dongguk University, I bring them to the Myeongdong, one of the city shopping center in Myeongdong, and a very beautiful woman just walking by, and they are smiling, something like that. So Arahant shouldn't be stimulated by the food, by the beautiful woman, by the money, and so, but they still become astray when they saw something, you know, when we saw the Ferrari, oh, nice car, something like that. So Mahadeva said, elderly monk in the temple, even though they insisted they are the arhat, but they cannot. And the second one, they still be the subject to ignorance. So arhat, the Buddha, when we think about it, it's a sarvajña, knower of everything. So any question given to the Buddha, Buddha can answer. So that's the one of the criteria to become the arhat. So during the time, you know, around the 140 years after the Buddha's pathway, when monk approach to the arhat asking question, and they said, I don't know. I don't know. I'm not sure about that. So that cannot be the arhat. They are still have avidya, you know, ignorance. And also, when they are not sure about some kind of question, young monk ask him, are you really Buddhist saint or not? And they said, I'm not sure. I think I'm the arhat, but I'm not sure. So there still is a doubt. You know, doubt is one of the things you should remove before you declare I'm the arhat. So they have problems. So when this kind of a thing occur in Pataliputra, big dispute starting to building up. So elderly monk, usually in the Buddhist temple, was called Stavira. Stavira. Stavira means sitting high in the position. So anybody watching the movie Harry Potter, I was in Oxford University, and my college was Mansfield College. And the Mansfield College has got very nice dining hall, and the dining hall where, you know, student usually eat on the bench. Bench means there is no backrest. It's just the bench, we sitting there. And we usually have just one plate. With just one plate, we put something on there and eat. But the teachers or graduate student, they have an elevated seat. We call it as a high table. High table. High table means there is an elevated platform, and they have a nice table with a chair, not the bench. Chair means you have a backrest. You have a backrest. Chair, and if you are eating here, you have a nice wine and soup and the main dish. It's very nice, very nice. So people sitting there, usually teachers or graduate students or lecturers. So they are usually elderly, you know, elderly person, and also teachers. Like a Dumbledore, you know, in the Harry Potter, they are more traditional and they are conservative. So people who got the view of a traditional and conservative, as well as people who are getting old, in the older days, they were called the Stāviras. So Stāvira, when it changed into the Pali, initial S disappear. So it become Stāvira, and semi-vowel disappear, and AI become E, so it become Tera, it become Tera. So Buddhism flourishing in this southern part of Asia was called the Theravada, Theravada. And Theravada, you know, around the 1800 in Myanmar, Theravada means traditional view on wearing your custom. So monks in Myanmar who insisted monks shouldn't show any part of their body, they should cover, you know, like that. That's the Theravada during the time in 1800 in Myanmar. And the monks who show the shoulder, you know, more like something, more like, how can I say, practical, more like a practical. Anyway, it become the name of the group who were on the Arahat side, elderly monk. So they become Stavira, Stavira. And another one, Mahasanghikas. Mahasanghika means a big gathering, not just a small gathering, big gatherings. So, this kind of a dispute occur and monk fighting each other. Elderly monk, the number is smaller. But young generation of the monk, and also there are lots of lay followers. They support not the elderly monk, but the young generation of monk. Because this is kind of, degradation of a Buddhist saint. All the elderly Buddhist saint, according to the young generation of the monk, according to the laity, they cannot be the saint. So their value is going down dramatically. Then just one person become going up. Who do you think just one person is going up? The one who has got perfect knowledge, one who knows everything, the one who totally remove all the passion and hatred and delusion, one who hasn't got any problem and safely disappear from endless rebirth. That's the Buddha. So I think this is the starting point where the Buddha become, superhuman, even higher than God. That's around 140 years after the Buddha's passing away. And around 100 years after, I pass away, 100 years later, nobody saw me. So nobody has got direct memory of me. And around 140, nobody can hear about me from the person who got direct memories. So that's the time the person become mystified, the person become legendary, the person become, around the person, the legend and so on building up. So this is the time when Buddhism focusing on, decorating the life of the Buddha. So the life of the Buddha during that time, we have miracles, Shravasti miracles, where Buddha flying high and showing his body duplicated, called the twin miracle. Or Devadatta tried to kill the Buddha by, mad elephant charging into the Buddha, and he just stopped. Or the Buddha was alone in the Bariyaka forest. Monkey and elephant try to give a food and so on. Oh, Buddha going up to the heaven. That sort of legendary things usually occur during the time building up. The Buddha become superhuman and so on. And that's the time when we have Jatakas, former life of the Buddha, where Buddha show extraordinary self-sacrifice, through the making merit of his extraordinary self-sacrifice, the Buddha accumulate the merit. So the end result, when the Buddha was born as a young boy, he has got 32 special mark on his body. He has got Usnisha, and he has got a mark of the wheel on the pit, and so on. So that's the time the Buddha become superhuman. And I have to say, I'm a laity. I want the Buddha be the superhuman. Then he can protect me, like I collecting amulet, and I believe this amulet will protect me. Just like that, the Buddha will protect me. So this is more like Buddhism become soteriologically a correct means for the ordinary people. So who support that kind of idea? They prepare a Mahasanghika, Mahasanghikas. So I think this is the first main schism or separation of the Buddhist Sangha. And you know, we have Mahasanghika Buddhist material. We have Mahabhastu. It's a Buddhist hybrid Sanskrit text about the life story of the Buddha. It's a full of legend, full of, you know, kind of exciting stories about the Buddha showing supernatural power, and the disciple of the Buddha also show the supernatural power. So I think the main reason why Buddhism first separate into the Stavira and Mahasanghika is about the Buddhology. How to see the Buddha was the main things. So in Pali Tipitaka, or especially Sutta, we saw many weakness of the Buddha. I wrote my PhD thesis on Nirvana, final departure of the Buddha. So before the Buddha passed away, he showed many you know, physical problems. So in one occasion, while the Buddha was giving the talk, he feel pain on his back. So the Buddha called Ananda. Ananda, please come. And Ananda asked him, why? I feel pain on my back. I'd like to take a rest. So I'm going to take a rest. You should finish my talk to Dojo monk. So Buddha actually showed his physical problem within the sutta. So which means there are monk, usually traditional and elderly monk, who try to keep human side of the Buddha within the Buddhist canon. So they become a poem called the Stavira. So that's the first main schism occur. But Mahasanghikas and Staviras peacefully stay together, peacefully stay together. So if you go to the Amaravati in India, eastern side, there's a kind of a Mahasanghika center where you can see full of legend of the Buddha. People all become very happy when they saw. And also northwestern center of Mahasanghika was the Bamiyan. Bamiyan in Afghanistan, you remember the Taliban destroyed huge Buddha statue. There you can see the inscription Mahasanghikas. So Mahasanghika there in the old days building huge Buddha stupa, Buddha statue, and believing, you know, supernatural power of that. So they peacefully stay together. So first Buddhist council, economic problem, city monks and rural monks, that's the problem. Second one, a Buddhology, how to see the Buddha. And the middle of that, we have another Buddhist dispute. That was called the arising of Vatsiputriyas. Vatsiputriyas. Vatsi is the name of the area in the Avanti. I believe it's in the rural area, western part of the Bihar. And the Putra means the son. The son of Vatsi, or son of the lady called the Vatsi. We can interpret in different ways. But the important thing is that this person insists we should accept the Buddhagala. And the Buddhagala is the person. If I say one Buddhagala and two Buddhagala, three Buddhagala, four Buddhagala, so Buddhagala. So the Buddhism, around 200 years after Buddha's pathway, they have got problem. Because on the one hand, Buddhists insist karma is working from the past. What I am is what I've done in the past. I am the result of what I've done in the past. So there should be some kind of things which ensure the identity of me in the past and me in the present. According to Hindus, according to the Brahmanical tradition, that was called the Atta or Atman. So Atman bring the identity of me in the past, present, and the future, so that the karma is working according to that identity. So any person who did wrong in the past, punished in the present. If I do something very correctly according to the good intention, I will be rewarded in the future. And which provide the identity? greatest Atman in Western tradition. It was called the soul, Atman, or self. We can translate variously. But Buddhism, from the very start, insisted, what was it? Anatta, anatta. Anatta in the early Buddhist text is a karma-dharya compound. So body cannot be the self. Feeling cannot be the self. Thinking cannot be the self. Intention cannot be the self. And consciousness cannot be the self. So there is no self within the person, you know. So the outcome could be a Bahubri compound of anatta, the person where there is no self. So we usually call it as a no soul theory, no soul theory. So according to the Buddhism, Atman, accepting the Atman is strictly prohibited. There are various ways to accept it, but basically it was prohibited. So this Vashibhutra insists we need Atman in order to explain a theory of karma. We need Atman in order to explain rebirths and so on. So he doesn't want to use the term Atman, so he used the term Buddhagala. So those people were called Buddhagalabada. Buddhagalabada. Many Buddhist sects criticize Buddhagalabada, but when Xuanzang, Chinese pilgrim, visit to India, Xuanzang recorded, you know, Kashmir area, 10 Buddhist temples. 7 belongs to Sarvastivada, 3 belongs to Mahayana. Or when he visited Sarnath, what kind of temple, what kind of Buddhist monk there. He recorded everything about the 620 common era, the situation of India. And surprisingly, about a third of Indian Buddhists belongs to here. Buddhagalabada, Buddhagalabada. During that time, they were called the Samitya. Samitya. They all belong to the Samitya. So think about India. Rejecting the idea of Atman is not easy, even the Buddhist. I always think, accepting the Atman, we can explain karma and rebirth in just 5 seconds. But rejecting the idea of Atman, we should explain human person consist of 5 aggregates, you know, 12 different shares and 18 dhatus, and that usually work according to the Pratitya Samutpada. It's very, very complicated for the general public. It's too difficult, too difficult. You know, Buddhism more like academic or more like psychotherapy, sometimes I feel like. So this is a kind of a popular form of the Buddhism occur, you know, before the third Buddhist council. So among the most important Buddhist council, I always said it's the third Buddhist council, this is among the most important one, third Buddhist council, during the time of King Ashoka, and the place, Pataliputra. Pataliputra nowadays was called the Patna. I visited Patna and I recorded the huge city of Patna. This is one of the oldest city in India, founded during, I remember, you know, in Mahaparinibbana Sutta, the Buddha trying to go to the Kushinagara from the Rajagriha. He had to across the river Ganges. And before he crossed the river Ganges, he met some Brahmin. A Brahmin general came meeting him, and he said he was building the new city south of the river. So that's the Pataliputra. So Pataliputra become, the capital of Maurya Empire. And Maurya Empire cover a huge amount of India. The current day India was actually formed during the time of the Mauryan Empire, starting with the Chandragupta, the first king, and the second king, Bindusara, and the third king, Ashoka. Here in this southern bank of Pataliputra, they build a city, a huge city. And then you remember Chandragupta, the first king? He's a giant supporter. And the second king, Bindusara, Ajivika is Ajivika supporter. And the Ashoka become Buddhist supporter. And the Ashoka build a huge Buddhist temple called Ashoka Arama. And there is problem. Even though nowadays we try to find out some kind of a trace of a Buddhist site in Patna area, it's almost impossible, as you can see here. City cover everywhere, so we can't make people going out to have a dig, you know, and it's almost impossible. So somewhere in this huge city, once there was a flourished Buddhist temple. So if you want to know more about King Ashoka and the Third Buddhist Council, you should go to Nakhonpattom. In Nakhonpattom, we have a Prapattom Chedi. And the Prapattom Chedi, we have a very, very, very nice wall painting of the King Ashoka according to the Southern Buddhist point of view. I'd like to take a photo and they stopped me. So I ended up with buying the book about the King Ashoka in that wall painting. It's very nice, nicely done. So this one, Ashoka has got problem because his father wants the first son, called I think Sumana or something. He wants to hand over the kingship to the first son, and Ashoka was not the first son. He disguised as the first son and get the crown from his father. His father was almost dying. He can't recognize anyone. So people said that this is your first son. He just gave him the crown. So. The next thing, how can I move it? The next thing King Ashoka did when he became the king, he was just searching the everywhere in the palace, and he starting to kill all, what is it, his brothers. 99 brothers, they were all killed. Anyone who doesn't want to kill, what to do? Become a Buddhist monk. Become Buddhist monk is okay because I have no desire on the secular thing. But anyone stay in the palace, showing some intention to become the king, they all die. So he killed everyone. But Ashoka thought that's not enough. So Ashoka ended up with killing all his brothers. And then what he did was showing his military power. Military power is one of the key things all the kings usually do in India. So he attacked eastern country called the Kalinga, and he destroyed the city and the 300,000 hostage coming back to the Magadha area, Pataliputra. Pataliputra became very strong country during that time. Luckily, Ashoka had a beautiful wife. Anybody know the name? The name of the first wife, Bidisha Devi. Bidisha is a flourishing merchant town just north of the Sanchi in the central India. So when King Ashoka was attacking Ujjain area, he was staying one night in very, very rich merchant house where he met his first wife, Bidisha Devi. Yeah, it's Bidisha Devi. She was a Buddhist. So she keep insisting, you should be a good person, giving arms around to the Buddhist monk and so on. But Ashoka continued to refuse. So this one, my favorite one. So Bidisha Devi insisted, King Ashoka, you should be a good man. And Ashoka, no, I'd like to be a king. I'm a man. I'd like to kill the person and continue to fight and so on. But when woman or wife keep insisting, Men cannot do anything about it. From my personal experience, my wife insisting I can't do anything about it. So step by step, King Ashoka become more like, you know, accepting the Buddhism. So the first, he let her build a small Buddhist shrine in the palace. And then he step by step knowing the Buddhism. And then one evening, when King Ashoka was on the corridor or veranda of the palace, he saw very, very young monk, a 5-year-old monk called Nigrodha. And according to the Pali commentary, Nigrodha was the son of the Ashoka's brother. So when he killed everyone, the one of the wife carrying the Nigrodha and hide, and it's too heavy. So just put him under the tree, Nigrodha tree. So monk pound him under the tree and rising up. So his name, Nigrodha. So Nigrodha, he just saw. And suddenly, King Ashoka wants to become a serious Buddhist, you know. So he going down there and give Anjali Mudra, and he accept him as his teacher. And what was the teaching of Nigrodha to Ashoka? It's appamada. So pamada is negligence. So everybody watching the lecture, anyone checking their Instagram and sending some heart, that's appamada, negligence. So everybody do meditate, and someone you know, sleeping, that's pamada. That's pamada. So pamada is very important. So in Buddhism, appamada, not to be lazy, do your best on something is very important. So in Mahaparinibbana Sutta, when we saw almost a final moment of the Buddha, there was a Pali sentence, I am tatakatasa pachimabacha. This is the last word of the Buddha. And last word of the Buddha, payadamma sankhara appamadena sampadeta. So appamadena, do your best. Not to be any you know, lazy, and so you do your best, achieve your goal. You should achieve your goal. So when I was in Oxford University, I have to take an exam, Sanskrit exam, make me crazy, you know. And then I feel like I should give up. I should give up. But whenever I feel like I should give up, I just remember appamadena sampadeta, the word of the Buddha actually giving me the power. So I keep continue, you know, and then succeeded in. So even nowadays, whenever I feel like I'm very, you know, not that strong, I like to give up and so on, I usually, you know, repeating myself, appamadena sampadeta. That's the last word of the Buddha. So as a Buddhist, I should follow his last word. So King Ashoka, this appamadena sampadeta, appamada. So the king said, as a king, I will not be lazy. As a king, I will not show any negligence. So the king said to his ministers that anything happened to the kingdom, you should come and tell me. Even when I was drinking, I was sleeping, I was enjoying and hunting and so on, you should come. I will not be any, you know, show any laziness in governing the kingdom. So when we checked many kings, Buddhist kings, many of Sri Lankan king said, I will not be, you know, lazy in governing the kingdom. They repeatedly said, you can inform me. And in Thailand, very famously, King Rangkamheng in Sukhothai actually said to his ministers, I will not be lazy governing my kingdom. You should come to tell me. And even one king in China, it's Yangtze in Su Dynasty. That's around 600 common era. He's a Buddhist king, even though his kingdom collapsed during the time. And he actually said, I will not be lazy governing the kingdom, so you should let me know. You know, it's starting with this Nigrodha and the King Ashoka. So Ashoka become a very faithful Buddhist, And all the support, you know, the royal support goes to the Buddhist Sangha. So all the royal support, Buddhist Sangha, and building Buddhist temple, and so on, Buddhism become bigger and bigger. And under the patronage of, you know, empire, Mauryan empire, Buddhism grow bigger and bigger. So in this temple painting, Prapatam Chedi, you can see here, Shivalinga. Shivalinga means a Hindu. I'm not sure whether Shivalinga was there during the time of the Buddha. Maybe Jainism or Ajivika could be main contender. Their temple was empty. Their temple was empty. So what they do? They just, you know, cut their hair by themselves, changing their clothes, and they become self-ordained monk. You know, ordination of a monk is very important in Buddhism. Ordination lineage is among the most important thing we like to keep. So become a monk means proper education. Together with the five monk or five bhikkhu agreed to give an ordination, then he become the proper monk. But here you can see many, how can I say, people who follow different religion, different idea during the time of the King Ashoka become self-ordained monk. And then they were together with a properly ordained monk in the Buddhist temple. Then fighting occur. According to the Buddhist canon, 7 years. Here, 7 years they cannot have a uposatha because of the fighting. They keep fighting each other. This is according to the story given in chronicles in the Pali tradition. But I'm not sure. But anyway, the King Ashoka sent a minister to settle down the dispute. And, you know, settling down fighting between husband and wife, very difficult. But even more difficult to settle down fighting between monk. It's almost impossible. So he become very upset. And he's starting to kill the Buddhist monk. And then he realized what he was done. It's an expression of a Buddhist Sangha. So he was hurried to go back to King Ashoka. I'm very sorry, but I tried to settle down the dispute between the monk, but during that I killed some monk. So King Ashoka thought, I really want to become supporter of the Buddhism. It was called the Dharma Raja. Dharma Raja means the king who support, who protect, who propagate Buddhism in his country. So that's his main task. So that the King Ashoka wants to be a Dharma king, but that's impossible because of that bloodshed occur in Ashoka Rama. So King Ashoka asked the monk, ministers, what should I do? And the minister said to King Ashoka, you should have a high monk, like a supreme patriarch, inviting to the Pataliputra and settling down. So Ashoka was checking who could be the best person, and who was it? Moggaliputta Tisha. I want to become a Theravada monk when I retire, and I already have my name, Moggaliputta Tisha, my Dharma name. Because this is one of the best names. Moggali is Moggallana, the best of supernatural power. And the Tisha is the name of the Sariputta. Sariputta, when he was very young, was called the Upatisha. So Moggali Buddha Sariputta's son is Moggali Buddha Tisha. So, you know, the person who got the name, the best in supernatural power and the best in the wisdom, I have to say. So Moggali Buddha Tisha coming to the court of the King Ashoka, he teach Buddhism just one week. And then Ashoka become one of the best Buddhist scholar. So I'm very sorry, I'm not that clever, excellent monk like Moggali Buddha Tisha. So 1 year, 2 years, 3 years, I can't do it. But Moggali Buddha Tisha, just 1 week, Ashoka become one of the best Buddhist scholar. And then they too go to the Ashoka Lama, try to settle down the dispute. Here you can see Ashoka together with Terras and the monks get together. And according to the Buddhist tradition, 120,000 monks get together there. And then King Ashoka ask a question. What is your viewpoint on this? What is your viewpoint on this? And here they have a screen. And behind the screen, King Ashoka, sometimes Moggali Buddha teacher, ask a question. So when they heard the answer, they separate them into two categories. And according to Northern Buddhist tradition, sixty thousand, and 60,000. So number is not important, which means they fight each other very tight. It's very close fight, and they very closely fighting together. And the two section become very very strong, 60,000 and 60,000. And the King Ashoka decided one group following the viewpoint of Moggali Buddha Tisha, the other group not following the Moggali, the viewpoint of Moggali Buddha Tisha. So King here, you can see, gave a white cross. And then King kicked them out from the Magadha area. So the monk kicked out from there, was called the Sarvastivada, Sarvastivada. Maybe I use this one. It's a nice Sanskrit name, Sarva. The viewpoint of existing everything. The viewpoint of existing everything. So everything, Sarva. Past. Present and future. That's the Sarvastivada. And monk who follow the viewpoint of Moggali Buddha Tisha, Vibhajavada, Vibhajavada. So Vibhaja means analytic or separation. B is the two. So Vibhajavada, instead of saying everything exists, they said Vibhajavada said something exists and something not exists. That's the Vibhajavada. So in Abhidhamma Kosha Bhasha, that's the Sanskrit text written in northern India by Basubandhu, one of the most brilliant Buddhist scholar, and he wrote the book Abhidhamma Kosha Bhasha. For a long time, we only have a Chinese translation, but during the 1930s, that text was discovered in the very small temple in Nepal. We got the Sanskrit version nowadays. And in this Sanskrit version, he explained, he explained very clean and nice Sanskrit, explained the difference between the two, Sarvastivada and Vibhajavada. Here, yehi sarvam asti iti vadanti, te sarvastivada, te sarvasti. Yehi sarvam asti iti vadanti atittam anagattam prati yutpannam cha te sarvasti vadaha yetu kimchit asti yat prati yutpanna adattapallam atittam karma kimchit na asti yat adattam palla atittam anagattam cha iti vibhajaya vadanti te vibhajavadinaha. This is one of the perfect sentence actually show the difference between the two. So here, atita means past. anagatta, future, prati yutpanna, present. So it's all accusative. So these all accusative goes to the sarvam. So past, future, and present, all of them are existing. People who said that was called the sarvastivada. And the other one, kimchit asti, something exists. Kimchit na asti. What is existing? According to them, present and the part of the past exists. It said, adatta palam cha atittam karma. Not make each result yet. So when I was 5 years old, for example, I was so hungry, so I just stolen some bread. So today I was punished by hit by the teacher. So that's the result. So in order to make that cause and result occur possible, we need the you know, presence of the past in order to make a realization of each result. So this Vibhajavada said the past karma still exists if the result was not yet, you know, exercised. So present and the past exist, non-existent future and past action already given each result. So that's the difference between the two. So I think this is one of the most important, you know, very, very serious schism. And the main issue is a theoretical reason. And the end result, people who follow this Sarvastivada kicked out from the Magadha area. So I think I have some map here. So I'm so sorry about that. So Bihar area is the center of King Ashoka and Mauryan Empire during that time. So anyone following Moggali Buddha Disha, anyone who has got the view of Vibhajavada can stay. But anyone follow Sarvastivada, they were kicked out. And according to the Buddhism, they first settled down in Mathura area, around 200 and 100 people common era. And then political situation in India changes. Because until around the Mauryan Empire and Sunga and the Palung Empire, Indian people got the initiative. And around 100 before Common Era to the 100 Common Era, Northwestern people entering into the India getting the power. Some of the Greek kingdom, you remember what is it? Milinda Pangha. Milinda is Menandros, is Indian Greek king. He got the power. And also Scythian in the Central Asia entering into the India, and they were called the Shaka. And the Shaka got the power in this northwestern part of the India. And then finally, Chinese people coming, not exactly Chinese. They are the Western people living in the western part of the China, called the Weiji. Weiji or Weiji. So Weiji people, during the time of Han Dynasty, they were how can I say sandwiched, because Chinese kingdom Han Dynasty built Jiangjing, you know, the huge great wall, and they were outside of the Jiangjing, and the Hun people coming, so they were sandwiched, so they can't stay there. So they starting to move a western part of China through the Central Asia, and around the first century before and after Common Era, they appear northern part of the India, and then around the you know first century AD Common Era, they built their own empire, and India it was called the Kushan. Kushan Empire. So Kushan Empire and the king usually called the Kanishka. And they are the one who was building up Silk Road from the China to the northern part of the India. And the Silk Road provide lots of profit because in China, they have a raw silk, you know, white silk. They get the raw silk. While they are moving through the Silk Road, usually in Kijil area, middle of the Central Asia, they got cobalt. Cobalt, you can color that the raw silk into a bright blue color. And when then they were in the northwestern part of the India, they have a lemon tree. So lemon tree, when they put the silk inside in the boiling water, the silk become bright red color. So, you know, raw silk from China in central and northern part of India, it become brightly colored, you know, silk. And then they made, you know, cloth. And then that cloth exported to the, you know, Mediterranean area or Persia. So it give a lots of profit. So Kushan is one of the biggest trading kingdom in India, in between China and the Mediterranean area. And the Kushans, maybe starting with the Zoroastrian religion, it's Persian, but once they enter, they become Buddhist. Lots of them become Buddhist. And Buddhism also try to make Kushan rulers to become Buddhist. They tried it. And their kingdom is a huge kingdom, I have to say, Kushan. Their center in northwestern India was called the Peshawar in Pakistan, now that's the Peshawar. But they also built the southern Indian capital under the Kushan. That's the Mathura. So during this time, the center of political power moving from the Magadha area or Pataliputra and so on to the central part of India. So Mathura become international city, you know, controlling trade and religion or some kind of cultural intercourse and everything, it become the trading center. So Sarvastivada, even though they were kicked out from the king during the time of the King Ashoka, strategically they were in the very nice position. And the following the Kushan power, monks moving from Mathura to the northwestern India. And some part of the Sarvastivada stay in the eastern part of the North India, called the Kashmir area. And another one settled down in the middle of a trading center that was called the Gandhara, centered around Peshawar. So two kind of Sarvastivada established there. They use Sanskrit. They use philosophical thinking, because in the northwest, they met the Greek people, they met Persians, you know, they building up grammatical books, they are building up treatises and so on. So they become one of the most strongest Buddhist sect in northwestern India until around 800 Common Era, and then step by step disappear. So that's the one part of Buddhist, starting with the Sarvastivada. They undergo so many changes. I will talk about it later. Because if Buddhism stay here in Magadha area, they do not have to change dramatically because they are dealing with the same people. But here in the northwest, think about there in the first or second century Common Era, there are Chinese merchants, there are Greeks and Romans, there are Scythians, they are, you know, Iranians. There are, you know, some people from nomadic area. They all mixed together. So I think during the time of the Kushan Empire, This Gandhara area become international center, and the international synthesis occur during the time when they get together. So the outcome is the starting of the Buddha image. So you remember before that Gandhara, maybe a Sanchi or Parahut, you can't see any the Buddha. But when you know that, you know, international synthesis occur there, the outcome is the Buddha image, because the Persians or Romans try to put their god into the human figure. So they need something to you know, make the Anjali Mudra. They no longer satisfied with the wheel. You know, in India we are okay with the wheel. In India we are okay with the just the chanting. But the Westerners, you know, they are warrior class. They are very, you know, no patience there. Quickly explain your doctrine and that pay homage to the Buddha statue. Something like that, you know. So the first one, occurring of the Buddha statue during that time. And second one, starting of Mahayana Buddhism. Because Buddhism there, they are dealing with the foreigners. They should offer something. You know, so more like traditional Buddhism is more like centered around, how can I say, practice, you know, self-practice, removing of all the desire and attachment. It's more like a personal and more like psychotherapy. But once they are in this area, they are dealing with Western or Eastern power, military group. So the only thing they can do, we can offer something. So dramatic change occur there in Gandhara area. So that's the Sarvastivada. So Sarvastivada go to the northwest, undergo so many changes. And the outcome was the image of the Buddha and the Mahayana Buddhism. I will coming back. And the Buddhism stay here.